Speaking from the hangar of the Fleming Grant Airways Corporation. During recent years, the whole world has become more and more transportation conscious. News has constantly flashed the experiments in revolutionary methods of transportation. Gathered before me are foreign diplomats, civic dignitaries, high-ranking army officials, and distinguished industrial leaders, all here to witness the christening of the new mistress of the air, destined to make history in transatlantic air travel, the Wild Goose. During the past few years, we witnessed the steady growth of aviation from an experiment to a giant network of air routes. Many great names have been enshrined on the honor roll of aviation's march of progress. This afternoon, we are privileged to meet and hear from one of its pioneers, the builder of the Wild Goose, known in the industry as the grand old man of aviation, Mr. John P. Fleming. Mr. Fleming. Mr. Fleming, I'm sure all of us here, and as well as the radio audience, would like to hear about the Wild Goose and what you expect it will accomplish for aviation.
Well, while transcontinental air travel is still in its experimental stages, I believe that in the Wild Goose we have a ship that will safely and comfortably carry passengers to and from Europe on a regular schedule.
When do you plan to inaugurate this schedule?
Upon the completion of my first test flight to Berlin and back.
Do you plan to take passengers on this first flight?
One. I shall be a star passenger.
Are you going to pilot the ship yourself?
Oh, no. Building them is one thing, flying them another. I've engaged the services of that distinguished flyer, Mr. Ace Martin, who, with his assistant, Joe Randall, will pilot the ship.
When do you plan to take off?
Just as soon as the weatherman gives us the word.
Now, is there anything else you'd like to tell us, Mr. Fleming?
Nothing, except that I should like to introduce the one whose constant encouragement has been my greatest aid in this new venture. My wife. Also, my junior partner, Mr. Sidney Grant.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fleming.
Thank you, Mr. Hayes.
And happy landing.
See the conquering hero comes. Sound the trumpet. Beat the drums.
The noisiest drum has nothing in it but air. This, my friend, is an occasion. Let's have some dignity.
Oh, well, it's Colonel Gimpy. Hello, Colonel.
Pardon me, sir. Has Madame yet christened the Wild Goose?
No, not yet, Colonel.
I'm sorry to have been detained. You may proceed.
Just a harmless eccentric. He thinks he's a colonel. He's been hanging around the field for months. The boys think he brings luck.
Colonel, Mr. Hayes.
How do you do, Colonel?
I'm happy to be in time, and I may consider being kind enough to speak over the air.
What would you like to say, Colonel?
Oh, I shall speak about cabbages and kings and various things. It's nice, isn't it? About kings and cabbages and various...
Careful, Colonel, now. Say just what I tell you.
I will.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a late arrival, Colonel Gimpy, who I've just learned is a familiar character around the airport.
I'm the mascot.
Oh, I'm sorry, Colonel. Colonel has just informed me that he's the mascot. Now, Colonel, this is all you must say. I'm happy to be here.
Must say I'm happy to be here.
And good luck to the Wild Goose.
And good luck to the Wild Goose.
All ready?
Happy to be here and good luck to the Wild Goose. I built the Wild Goose so I could fly to my country and rejoin my cavalry regiment, because I'm the chief trumpeter, the chief of all the trumpeters, and they cannot charge without me. And now I shall speak about cabbage.
Well, thank you very much, Colonel. That's very
things.
Nice. Thank you a lot.
Hooray! Hooray!
Right, thank you. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, that was Colonel Gimpy, the mascot at the airport.
Oh, Mr. Martin. Miss Gomez has been most anxious to meet you. Miss Gomez, Mr. Ace Martin.
How do you do, Miss Gomez?
How do you do, Mr. Martin?
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that famous daredevil flying organization, the top gallants, have just arrived. They're appearing here today in honor of their most distinguished members, Mr. Fleming, Mr. Grant, and Mr. Ace Mock. I want you to hear these Death Defiers sing. They're great.
Ring to the top gallants. Ring to the top gallants. Though we don't know who's the next to go, expect to go. For the devil may care. We take things as they come, with a smile, a song, and a dance. Come our shoes, fat, coats, hats. Anyone looking us over can tell at a glance. We're the top gallants. Ring to the top gallants. Ring to the top gallants. Though we don't know who's the next. Expect to go, for the devil may care, we're men of the air. We take things as they come, with a smile, a song, and a dance. From our shoes, fat, coats, hats, anyone looking us over can tell at a glance. We're the
Those are the top gallants singing their famous flying song. They're here today to honor the man who will guide the wild goose on his dash to Berlin, Mr. Fleming's pilot, Mr. Ace Martin. I'm going to try to persuade Mr. Martin to say a few words. Just a few words, Mr. Martin.
No, thank you.
Well, perhaps on land, Mr. Martin is lost for words. Anyway, best of luck to you, Mr. Martin.
Hello.
Hello, Colonel.
That really was a magnificent speech. You know, a man sees nothing because he's wise, or afraid, or stupid. Which are you?
Wise as an owl.
An owl? You know, an owl in daytime, she can't see, like this. And in nighttime, she can. Goodbye.
Great little fellow, the Colonel.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. Fleming, the builder's wife, will christen the ship.
We're ready, dear.
I christen thee Wild Goose.
Hooray!
How about some music?
Hello, Joe. Hello, Ruth.
Hello, Eddie.
Hello, Eddie.
What do you want, honey?
Oh, something simple.
How about a Tailspin Sunday?
All right.
I'll have the same. Won't be long before I'll be up there, on my way to Berlin.
Joy, I'm scared. I'm beginning to wish you weren't going.
I guess that tells me something, even if you hadn't meant to. Don't it?
Well, naturally, I don't want anything to happen to you.
When the company starts flights to Berlin, maybe someday we'll fly over on our honeymoon. And I'll be the pilot. How about it?
Maybe.
That's swell.
But you're a long way from being a pilot yet.
Oh, I don't know so much about that. What do you think Ace Martin's been grooming me for, huh? What was I a couple of months ago? A grease monkey. Ace likes my work and breaks me in for his mechanic. Even lets me sleep in his apartment tonight so he can give me talks on navigation. Now he thinks I'm good enough to fly to Berlin with him. Must be some reason for all that, and if it ain't because I got the makings of a good pilot, then what?
I know he's terribly fond of you.
Maybe I wouldn't go to town for him, too. He's the greatest flyer that ever lived, and the best friend. So what do you say, honey? You want to get engaged?
Who are you proposing for? Ace Martin or yourself?
Well, now...
Oh, hello, kid.
Hello, Mr. Martin. I want you to meet Miss Ruth Franklin, my fiancée.
Why, Joe.
Oh, how do you do, Ruth? Congratulations. You got a swell guy in Joe when he's in the air. Of course, I don't get a chance to see much of him on the ground, except the apartment when he comes home nights late.
She knows where I am.
Oh, yeah? You know he came home last night with his lips all over his chin, two big red gashes above his eye?
I've heard how you love to tease, Mr. Martin.
Oh, no, Ruth. I know a lot about you. Let's see. You lunch at the Canary Drugstore, chicken sandwich and a malted milk. You dine at Little Red Ink Joint on 51st Street. You like spaghetti. On warm nights, you like to sit on a bench on Riverside Drive. Cold nights, you like to go dancing. But you always go home at 11:30 sharp. 10 minutes later is when I start to hear about you. Tell you another thing. You work in a filing room at a trucks and aircraft plant. You have no assistant, you're overworked, and you're kept there after everyone else is gone. Correct?
And that's where Joey comes in. He comes and waits for me.
And that's where I come in, too. A watchman gets my good cigars for keeping his mouth shut.
Boss, you said I could help myself.
Sure I did. Now that I've met Miss Franklin, I think that watchman's going to start smoking better cigars. Well, goodbye, Ruth. See you later, kid. I'm going to go get something to eat.
I think he's grand.
So to go for him, huh?
Oh, I didn't mean that, you silly.
Well, he's the only guy I wouldn't squawk about if you did. That's what I think of him.
Hello.
Good evening, Colonel. The usual?
Mm-hmm.
Quiet.
Cabbages and kings are marvelous things.
Good evening, Baron.
Good evening. Did Operative Ferdy get here yet?
Not yet, Baron.
Have him come in when he does. I'm also expecting Operative 16. Not through that door. Use this one.
Anything new at the airport today?
Yes. Quite a good deal.
Nothing wrong, I hope.
No, nothing. Except that I fear we've been betrayed by one of our own men.
What do you mean?
I mean that our chances of getting Mr. Is Martin to obtain those DUX plans for us are now doubtful.
I thought...
Yeah, that we had everything running smoothly, so did I.
Has Martin now refused to do it?
No. He still hopes to get a hold of him through his mechanic, Randall, by using the scheme we had outlined for him.
Then what are you worrying about?
The possibility that others beside us may have learned of it and make him a higher offer. Knowing his past record, he would accept it too.
Aren't you borrowing trouble, Baron?
No. As you shall see.
Operator number 30 is here, Baron.
Yeah, send him in.
Good evening, Baron.
Good evening. Beautifully cut coat you have on.
Thank you, Baron.
You should compliment your tailor. You and your lady friend were the most distinguished couple at the christening this afternoon.
Thank you, Baron.
You were there in line of duty, weren't you?
Yes, Baron. Carrying out your orders.
That charming young lady I saw you with, old friend?
I've known her for some weeks. She's Senorita Gomez. Her father is a planter in Havana.
So, the daughter of a planter in Havana. She's, of course, unaware of your identity.
Oh, absolutely, Baron.
Operative, number 16 is here, Baron.
Come in.
You two know each other, huh? Our compatriot was just telling me that you and he are quite friendly.
How friendly? Perhaps I better put it this way. How much have you been able to learn from your devoted companion?
I know that for the past few months he's been working as your agent. He has acted as your intermediary with Ace Martin, who is trying to obtain for him the DOX bomber plans, for which Martin is to get $20,000.
But Baron!
Silence. That will be all now, thank you. And now, my loyal countrymen, what have you to say for yourself?
Baron, you must understand. This was not just an acquaintanceship. I loved her. And she led me to believe that she loved me. Oh, I thought surely I could trust her.
I understand you very well. Youth, romance, blissful days and nights went to your head, made you dizzy.
So dizzy that you risked a chance of betraying your country.
Baron, please believe me. This shan't happen again.
I'm certain of that. Unfortunately, I have no other choice but to relieve you of your present assignment. Come with me, please. I don't enjoy doing this, but I will go on doing it as long as it's necessary to carry on my work. The work for our country, to which I've dedicated my life. Send for Operative 77 from Washington at once.
Oh, hello, kid. What's the matter? No red marks tonight? What'd you do, wash your face or have a quarrel?
The way you kidded us this evening, she ditched the lipstick.
Nice girl, Joe. How'd you do it?
I'm still guessing. You know, it scares me sometimes wondering, will she wait till I get the price?
Don't you worry. When we bring down the wild goose in Berlin, you'll be on easy street. And your girl won't have to work for that scrub Cruxton. Mix yourself a drink.
Thanks, Mr. Martin.
Don't wait for me to ask you. You live here. And another thing, stop calling me Mr. Martin.
Thanks, but even being here is an imposition.
Cut it. Glad to give you the boost I got when I was in your spot.
I never knew anybody ever got behind you, Mr. Martin. Ace?
Yeah, he's dead now. He put me through Trinity Tech.
Trinity Tech? Then you're an engineer, so you ought to be building airplanes.
Something in that. Anyway, that kind of work right now brings up something I'm trying to forget.
Sorry I brought it up, Ace.
While we're on it, let me give you a tip. The minute you can support that nice girl of yours, in an inexpensive home, you hop to it. Don't wait around for this luxury stuff. That's where I stub my toe. Come here, I want to show you something. We'd be married 5 years now if I hadn't been a sap. I was pulling down 20 a week when we were engaged. Then I figured out a special propeller for a hydroplane. Well, I knew I had something big, so I sold her on the idea of waiting till we got hold of a fancy income. But I sold it so strong that when the income didn't materialize, she got tired of waiting and married somebody else.
Didn't your propeller turn out?
I'll say it did, but not for me. Where's my drink?
The other room.
Yeah.
Somebody swipe your idea?
Oh, the same old story. Sucker inventor and a smart businessman. Better make yourself a nightcap.
Thanks. You don't mind telling it, I'd like to hear about it.
Yeah? Well, kid,
If you ever invent anything, you chase right out to a throat specialist. Get him to fix you up so you can't talk.
Oh, you spilled your idea.
All over New York. I'd spend 12 or 14 hours working on it. And I'd go out and tell the whole world about it. Well, one day I ran across Mr. Cruxton.
You mean Ruth's boss?
Yeah, that's the guy. Asked me to bring my plans around. Said he wanted to give them a little study. Well, not knowing any better, like a fool, I left them.
So?
Oh, the usual formula. Next time I called, he said he was still studying them, but I'd know in a day or two. After that, I called for a couple of weeks before I saw him again. Then he said they weren't so hot, but he was still studying them. I finally heard from his secretary that my plans had been mislaid.
I wonder you didn't go to him and have it out with him, a showdown.
But by then I lost the girl I'd done it all for. Then I began to wonder if the plans were any good myself.
Say, are they any good, Ace?
Any good? I'm proud to say that due to Mr. Cruxton's intensive study, my DOX plans are worth a couple of $1 million. To him, not to me.
Would they still be valuable to you today?
I'll say they would. Why? What are you thinking about?
Say, I think I can get a hold of them for you.
Nix. I don't want you to get mixed up in it. Besides, that Cruxton file room isn't so easy to get to, or I'd been there myself.
Yeah, but that's just it. I can get to it easy, through Ruth.
No, I don't want to harm her. Why, she'd get fired so fast.
Oh, she wouldn't know anything about it. I'd handle it myself.
Nix. Forget it. Skip it. The only reason this whole thing came up is because I suggested you two kids get married now. Don't wait until it's too late. Now, you forget you ever heard of the DOX, you understand?
Yes, sir.
Well, I'm going to bed.
I think I'll have a cigarette first.
Well, don't smoke yourself to death. Good night.
Good night.
Good morning, Baron. Operative 77 is here, sir.
Have him come in. Good morning.
Good morning, Baron. I didn't know you were in America.
I've been here many months. I came over here in a very important mission. So important that if I failed, he would expect me to resign.
I am completely at your service, sir.
Thank you. We are after the plans of the DOX bomber plane, which I am in possession of the Cruxton Aircraft Company.
I know the plant well. A very difficult place for operatives to get into. They won't hire foreigners.
Money gets in anywhere.
Baron, are you aware that practically every war office in the world is offering a tremendous reward for those plans?
That's the point. Extreme secrecy and speed.
Have you made much progress?
Yes. We are putting our money on a man who will undoubtedly manage it. Only, I don't trust him.
May I ask who he is?
H. Martin, the flyer.
Ah, yes, I know of him. Clever fellow. Of course, you understand that he's in espionage merely for the profit.
Exactly. Arrange a meeting at once and test him in the usual manner.
Very well, Baron. Is that all?
Yes, thank you.
I have the money.
You speak in riddles.
I have the money.
Very well, produce it.
I'll meet you halfway.
Okay. Begin. What's on your mind?
Have a cigarette, Martin?
Thanks.
My
Martin, I was not sent here by the chief.
I see.
And what I have to say is only between us.
Shoot.
Suppose I could offer you more for those plans than you've been promised.
Are you suggesting that I sell out to some other country?
Well, let's say as a businessman that you sell to the highest bidder.
Testing me, huh?
Yes. As a matter of fact, I was sent by the chief. Huh. But in reality, I was testing you for myself.
I don't get you.
You will.
Oh, I'm beginning to see daylight. You're supposed to be a loyal agent of the chief's, whoever he is. That means you're a loyal subject of his country, whatever that is. But in reality, you're an agent for your own country.
Precisely that.
What is your country?
For the moment, we refer to it as country number two.
What's your proposition?
It's quite simple. Country number one has appointed me as intermediary to pay you the $20,000 when you deliver the plans. Now, that money I'll bring you, and it's all yours for your trouble.
Where do you come in?
My country, that is, country number two, has authorized me to pay you triple the amount, but on one condition.
What is it?
At the moment you get them, you deliver the plans and myself to my homeland by plane.
I see. You're afraid country number one will put the Indian sign on you.
Exactly.
Where is your country?
Not far from the destination of your proposed flight.
Oh, you mean you want me to take you with me on my flight in the Wild Goose?
Do you suppose that could be arranged with Mr. Fleming?
Yes, I think it could.
Then it's a deal?
It's a deal. Well, kid.
Do I deliver or do I deliver?
I'll say you do. Well, it's been a long time since I laid eyes on those babies. Kid, I don't know how to thank you, but I'll reciprocate someday.
Oh, forget it. After all you've done for me, nothing to it anyway.
How'd you get away with it?
Just like I thought I would. I'm up there waiting around for Ruth. The big filing vault's open, so Ruth steps out for a moment and I stroll in, just like I was looking around. I see a little drawer marked DOX and pull it out. There before me is the envelope. I stick it in my pocket, shut the door, and saunter out.
Where was Ruth?
Busy with her lipstick. How's that?
That's right. Your face is all gashed up again.
Felt kind of queer for a moment swiping something. I guess the fella's got a right to swipe what's his own, and after all, I was acting for you.
Don't you worry about that. If there's any criticism, I get it. It was my idea. I think I'll put this in the safe. I wouldn't say anything to Ruth about this. It'll just make her feel uncomfortable.
Sure. Of course, she'll hear about it when you put your claim in.
Yeah, we'll all hear about it in a big way, kid. And you'll get yours, no fooling.
No, don't bother about that, Ace.
I mean it. Yeah, this is Ace Martin. Who?
Oh, yeah, he got home.
Did he get them?
Yeah. Now, listen, as soon as Fleming is ready to take off, I'll get in touch with you. Don't worry. Okay, good night.
Well, did he accept your offer?
On the contrary. When I suggested it to him, he became indignant. He said that although he was not bound by any patriotic obligations, when he made a deal, it was a deal.
So you are certain he's to be trusted?
Absolutely.
Good work.
Thank you.
Now, the gentleman who was formerly our intermediary is no longer with us. Explain to Mr. Martin that the incident was a necessary test and that you are to continue on the case for us.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Everything.
And you have kept it a secret, of course, from Mrs. Fleming?
Yes, sir.
Good.
Matthews, when you serve the coffee, will you bring this in? It's a gift for Mrs. Fleming.
But Mrs. Fleming won't be home, sir.
Won't be home? What do you mean?
She left this afternoon rather hurriedly. She asked me to give you this note.
Hello, Ace.
I'm glad I found you in.
Can you get a hold of that young mechanic of yours? Good. Well, I've got a surprise for you. We're hopping tonight.
Yeah? Swell. I like it sudden like that, boss. Matter of fact, couldn't suit me better.
We're taking off secretly. I'm not even telling Mrs. Fleming or Grant. Yes, it's a sneak flight. Oh. Well, how about midnight?
Perfect. Leave everything to me, boss. I'll cable ahead and reserve a ringside table in a Berlin cabaret for tomorrow night. Okay, meet you at the hangar at midnight.
Ah, what are you dialing up for? You know how love is, especially on Wednesday night.
You don't get annoyed if the milkman gets here first.
You know where you'll be when the milkman comes?
Sure. On a bench on Riverside Drive, floating on clouds.
You'll be floating on clouds, all right. 600 miles out over the Atlantic.
We taking off?
Midnight sharp.
Yahoo! 9 o'clock. Just got time to tell Ruth.
Wait a minute. You can tell Ruth from Berlin tomorrow night. The takeoff's secret. Everything's under your hat.
I gotta tell her something. We got a date.
You can explain from Berlin. Do you get it?
Okay.
Now look, I want you to chase down to the Times drugstore. Pick up a package I'll phone for, then get out to the airport as quick as you can. All right, beat it.
Don't be back?
Yeah, yeah, I'll pack your toothbrush. On your way.
Okay, this is how I like it.
Yes? Oh, it's you.
Now, look, we're leaving tonight. Meet me on the Tower Road, 10:30, the same place. Come alone and bring the dough.
Did you arrange it with Fleming?
No, no, I'll fix it with him at the hangar. Now, we get a move on.
All right, I'll see you later.
10,000 and 20,000. You will hand this to Martin only when you've examined the blueprints.
Very well, Baron. I should be back in about an hour, sir.
Just a moment. We'll go with you in the car.
Why, but Baron, if he should see others with me in the car, why...
I'll manage that. You may need protection, huh?
Car ahead, Baron. Oh, I'm afraid I've killed the motor, sir.
Doesn't matter. Walk over to Martin and get those plans. Remember, nothing must go wrong. And the whole thing shouldn't take over a few seconds.
Yes, Baron. Don't move. The chief, he
He's got me covered. We must hurry.
Why, you double-crosser, so you thought you'd bring them along and put the Indian sign on me, huh? Well, here's yours.
Get in and start the car.
Wonder if that guy Fleming's gonna be late.
The odds. We got all night.
Yeah, well, he better not be, or we'll hop without him.
Jeez, you're sweating like a bull.
Yeah? Well, you would be, too, if you had your heart set on this like I have.
Nobody's gonna stop us.
Yeah, you can play that bet across the board. Come on.
I wonder if... What's the gun for?
Gate was open, wasn't it? Watchman missing. Something phony about that. You sure that gate was open?
How else could I get in? Gee, Ace, you're on edge.
Come on, we're not going to wait any longer. Let's roll her out.
Right.
Wait a minute. Here comes Fleming now.
Hello, boys. Are we all set?
All set. Let's get going.
Well, I'll get dressed in a minute. Where's my suit?
You can change inside. When we got here, the gate was open. The night watchman was missing. He may be talking to reporters.
What would he know?
Well, he might have seen the gas tank being wheeled in. Come on, let's go. High noon, lunchtime in any man's country.
It's breakfast time in New York.
Don't be so technical, Mr. Randall. It's lunchtime out here. Bust out the groceries.
What's our position, Ace?
About 1,500 miles out of New York. This coffee mill's still grinding them out. I'm afraid you turned out quite a crate. Still a little tail heavy, though.
I can't understand that.
Help yourself.
No, thanks.
What's the matter? Don't you feel well?
No, I'm all right.
A little homesick, huh?
Yeah, a little.
I thought so. Well, how about unburdening ourselves to a news-hungry world?
Okay.
KHAPQ, calling Atlantic Airport. Give me a call, please. KHABQ, calling Atlantic Airport. Give me a call, please. KHABQ, calling Atlantic Airport. Give me a call, please.
Strange. No answer.
Better check your transmitter. Maybe they're not getting you.
Transmitter tubes on sending set are burned out. That is a doornail.
Ha! That is a pity. Disappointing my public. Your sweethearts. Well, cheer up, boys. Absence makes the heart grow fonder. Attaboy.
You hear something?
Yeah. Ship's haunted.
It's Gimpy.
Hello.
So you stowed away on us, huh?
I have perhaps imposed upon your wildly known hospitality, Mr. Fleming.
I'll say you have.
It was unavoidable. You can't possibly realize how important it is for me to return to my country on this plane.
No wonder we had a time getting the tail up. He liked to have killed us.
Mr. Martin, I may still enjoy the distinction of killing you. Only for the present, I have a very special reason for letting you live. Who knows what the stars ordain?
I do.
You do?
Yeah, because in a minute I'm going to toss you over to the mermaids. You ought to do all right with the mermaids. Handsome boy like you.
I shall be sorry to disappoint them, but I have a previous engagement.
How did you get on here?
Me? Oh, just by submitting to the demands of stern necessity. I had to be here. I have an appointment in Europe. His Royal Highness.
Yes, we know all about that. But how'd you get by Blake the Watchman?
Blake the Watchman? Your faithful Mr. Blake, unfortunately, was an obstacle that, shall I say, had to be liquidated.
What do you mean?
Oh, he died peacefully in my arms. I killed him. Through the heart. You see, the heart is the most important organ in your whole system. If the heart stops, your body won't function any longer. You see, an elephant, for instance, you can shoot behind the ear. But in the case of Mr. Blake the Watchman, I prefer the heart.
Scram, will you?
Shooting through the heart does away with so much unpleasantness. Won't you agree with me, Mr. Martin?
Say, we've had enough of this.
I'm sorry, but the nerves of Mr. Martin are not of the best. Maybe, perhaps, the excitement of a sudden departure?
Sit down, you're rocking the boat.
Oh. Again, I must impose upon your hospitality. You see, my decision to join you was so sudden that I didn't have time to arrange for my itinerary. It's awfully crowded in here.
News flashes of the day by the Macklin Company. Since 6 o'clock this morning, no word has been received from the wild goose now en route over the Atlantic. Millions of men, women, and children wait breathlessly in the hope that this is not due to any misfortune that might have befallen Mr. Fleming, the owner, and his intrepid associates, Ace Martin and Joe Randall. If you are listening in, Mr. Fleming, good luck and Godspeed.
Why is my name not mentioned? Get in touch with them at once. At once, please.
A flash. Police have found a man dead on Tower Road, shot through the heart early this morning. Papers found on the body indicated that the man might have been a Secret Service agent of a foreign country. The United States Supreme Court is expected
I see it all clearly now. Very neat murder.
Quiet, Colonel, quiet.
Turn that thing off before he drives me mad.
Madness, Mr. Martin, is a very common malady. Can it be that they are mad themselves who call me mad? If you only knew what was going on in this head of mine. If you only knew.
She's usually here on the dock, fellas. Here she comes now.
Come on, Bill, now make this good. Come on, let's get a good picture. All right, I'll get over here in this way.
Good morning, Miss Franklin. Franklin, Mr. Croxton wants to see you in his office right away.
Thank you, Buck.
Oh, good morning, Ruth.
Good morning, Mr. Croxton.
I've sent for you, Ruth, to... Oh, this is Mr. Harrington of the War Department, Miss Franklin.
How do you do?
We're in a little trouble, and Mr. Harrington wants to ask you some questions. Sit down. Here.
Miss Franklin, you're in charge of the filing vault, I believe.
Yes.
And you've been working there after hours of late, have you not?
Yes, for the past month I've been kept late about twice a week.
And until you leave, you're practically alone in that room.
Yes, I'm always the last one there to close the safe.
Miss Franklin, did you have a visitor last Monday night?
Yes, Mr. Randall called for me. He often does. I have Mr. Cruxton's permission.
You're a very close friend of Mr. Randall's, are you not?
Yes, we're engaged.
On last Monday night, was he alone in the room with you?
Well, yes.
Did you notice what he was doing?
Not particularly. I was busy with my work. He usually sits around or walks up and down. Will you please tell me what this is about?
Just a moment, Miss Franklin. You say he walked about the room. Did you see him walk into the filing vault?
Why, of course not. What are you driving at? Is there something missing?
An envelope containing valuable blueprints of vital interest to the War Department is missing from that safe.
What in the world would Joe Randall know about things like that? He's a flyer.
Is that all you can tell us, Miss Franklin?
Absolutely.
I'm sorry, but it's not enough. You will have to come along for further questioning.
But I don't know anything. Please, Mr. Cruxton, there must be some mistake. I don't know anything about it, I swear it, and Joe doesn't either. He wouldn't do such a thing. You must believe me. Please, please.
Is this quite necessary? Miss Franklin's been in my employ for several years, and...
Sorry, but I'm afraid it is.
I'm afraid you'll have to go with him, Ruth. Now, don't worry. I'll do all I can for you.
Thank you, Mr. Cruxton.
Will this clammy fog ever let up?
I've had plenty of it, too.
Any idea at all where we are?
Over India, for all I know. They've been flying blind for hours.
Over India? Oh, in that case, you'll have to land me at once.
I'd more than like to accommodate you.
I am dining tonight with the Maharaja of Murat.
Oh, sure, Colonel, sure.
Some ship would only spot us from below and give us a call. We can get our bearings.
I know I'll have plenty to say to the bandits who installed this radio.
And the good old game of fooling each other goes on. I fool you, and you fool me.
Time for that news reporter again, Mr. Fleming.
News flashes by the Macklin Company. At noon hour today, 3,000 textile workers of the Rahway Underwear Mill walked out on strike. A spokesman for the workers said, no money, no undies. Still no word as yet from the Wild Goose or from passing ships at sea. Considerable alarm is being felt in view of Uncle Sam's weatherman reporting storms off the Irish coast.
I thought this was India.
Flash, the beginning of a scandal which may involve a famous personage in aviation circles was unearthed today by your snooping reporter.
Mm-hmm.
Source of this information has been carefully
checked. Quiet, please.
Quiet, please. Substantiated. A young woman employee of the Cruxton Aircraft Company is under arrest and is being detained by authorities. To say more would be telling, but your reporter has a word for this young woman's boyfriend, should he be listening. For whom did you get that envelope?
For whom, huh?
And here's the stock market report.
I could answer that question, but why should I tell you?
Pipe down.
With pleasure. In a company of fools, a mental giant always sounds ridiculous.
Well, if you fellas don't mind, I think I'll go and get some rest.
Okay, boss.
For the remainder of the voyage, I shall play upon a muted instrument.
Going sour on that noise yourself, huh? You're not so goofy.
Yes?
Major, Mr. Cruxton is here now.
Please have him come in. The
And have Mr. Harrington bring in Miss Franklin.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, Mr. Cruxton.
Hello, Major.
Mr. Cruxton, I sent for you. Oh, sit down, Miss Franklin. How are you, Harrington? Mr. Cruxton, we're convinced that those plans were stolen by Joe Randall and turned over to Ace Martin. Randall was unwittingly and innocently drawn into this through Martin's diabolical scheming.
Are you sure of that?
Definitely. By checking these clues on a body found on Tower Road, we, in conjunction with the Department of Justice, were led to the headquarters of a foreign spy syndicate. There we arrested two men. On a promise of protection until they were being deported, they agreed to talk, which they did. Then, being dead certain the plans were on the wild goose, we cabled every American merchant marine vessel on the Atlantic to be on the lookout for the airship. We also stationed our men at the airport in Berlin with instructions to take Martin into custody when he arrived. But Martin is not headed for Berlin.
How do you know that?
A message in code from one of our vessels on the South Atlantic informs us that they definitely sighted the wild goose. Now, judging from the vessel's position, Martin is flying 500 miles off his course. It may be that they're lost, but it may be deliberate. At any rate, I'm afraid we haven't a chance to recover those plans before Martin can dispose of them to some foreign power.
Major, you said you believed Joe to be innocent, didn't you? Well, if he will bring those plans back, would his name be clear?
Yes.
Then why don't you let me speak to him, over the radio, I mean?
Why,
Please, Major, I'll talk to him. I'll tell him how Martin has used him and how much those plans mean to his country. He'll get them. I know he will.
That'd be a good idea, Major. A chance worth taking.
It might at that.
Then you'll let me do it?
Judging from Martin's way of doing things, however, I'm compelled to warn you that from this, serious consequences may result in that airship.
Even so, Joey must know. He'd want to know. Please let me do it. Please.
Very well. Arrange to clear all air lanes at once.
Pretty rough weather, Ace.
You said it. First we get hours of pea soup fog, and now this.
Come hither, hither, my little page. Why dost thou weep and wail? Or dost thou dread the billow's rage? Or tremble at the gale? But dash the teardrop from thine eye. Our ship is swift and strong. Our fleetest falcon scarce can fly more merrily along.
Oh, poet, huh? You just make it up?
That, my ignorant friend, was written by Byron.
Byron? Oh, how stupid of me.
You are the quintessence of stupidity. When I consider the sum of what is contained in that skull of yours, I am proud to be a nitwit.
What's wrong now?
It's the gas cap. It's come loose.
Take it over. Yep. Gotta fix that pronto. We may need every drop of that bang water before we're through.
You're not going out on that wing, Ace. It's certain death.
Certain death for all of us if that thing continues to spray.
Let me go, Ace.
You never did a wing mark before. You wouldn't last a minute.
Yeah, I know, but
on my way, I'll throttle her down. Hold her in a stall. On my way in, bank her a little.
Okay.
Mr. Martin, I must admire his courage.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Department of Justice, in an effort to reach the wild goose, has requested us to clear all air lanes for its official business.
Joy, this is Ruth. They've arrested me. They know you stole those plans for Ace Martin. Joy, Ace Martin is not your friend. He lied to you. He's a spy. Those plans are important to the American government. He has them with him, and they mustn't reach Europe. Oh, Joey, I love you.
No! I'm gonna throw him off!
Oh, please!
He made me get those plans for him. He said they were his!
No, you can't kill a man in cold blood, no!
Fool, listen. He's got the plans in his pocket. Wait until he comes back.
Okay, Joe, stop it.
Okay.
Be right again, it did. Thought I was gone for a minute. What ails you?
Well, you tried to blame me for a sucker.
Huh? Eddie Jones.
Those plans you made me steal, they belong to the government. You knew it.
What started all this?
Message over the radio from Miss Franklin.
Is this humor?
Hardly, Martin. This is no place for trouble. You better hand them over.
My plans? Joe knows they're my plans.
Let's see them.
Yes, let's see them.
Well?
Have you gone nuts?
Hand them over.
How about some more ice water for these lamps of mine? They're like two hot coals.
I hope they burn through your skull.
Don't worry. They probably will. These lamps of mine will never see daylight again. When do you other guys soak this bandage?
I don't know which is more merciful. Refusing to help you or telling you there's no more water.
That's it. Thanks.
Maybe that was the kid's way of telling me the same thing.
Yeah? If I had my way, I'd wash your eyes out with soap water.
Okay. Can't say I blame him much.
What's the use, Joe? Stewing won't get you anything.
I'm not stewing.
Doesn't the futility of all this track you, gentlemen, as amusing?
Not amusing enough for you to start tooting that horn of yours, I hope.
I seem to lose my talent for the instrument when the ship crashed.
Yeah. Certainly sobered you up. Wouldn't it be funny, Colonel, if this crack-up knocked some of those maggots off your brain?
Yes, very funny.
Martin!
Oh. Sorry, Colonel, I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. Just wanted to keep talking. What are you doing, boss?
Trying to fix this old melodeon.
Knock off. When lightning strikes those things, they're out for good.
Well, at least it keeps my mind off things.
Yeah. What's occupying your mind, Colonel?
Oh, contemplating the wonder of the firmament and thankful to the stars for keeping the sea so peaceful.
Well, you needn't thank them for me. And just as soon they played leapfrog with each other.
I don't want to go out in a bathtub. Give me a storm. Roughhouse. Excitement. Bet I know what the kid's doing. Standing there leering at me. Ready to throttle me, ain't you, kid? Well, come on, cut loose. I can stand an encore. I made you a traitor. You lost your girl. Now you're gonna die.
I ain't scared to die. I prefer it to what you've left to me at home, and the sooner the better.
Easy, Joe.
What are we waiting for anyway? No food, no water, nothing. Just sitting here waiting for the sea to drag us down inch by inch. I don't care what you guys think of me. Call me yellow if you want to, but I can't stand this. I can't stand it.
Sit down.
Let me go. Let me go. Let me off.
She's souping it up like a sponge.
Yeah, about 2 feet in the last hour.
Won't be long now.
Are you ready, Colonel?
Uh-huh.
Go. Yeah, that's six in a row. You should have been an admiral instead of a colonel.
What time is it?
Ten thirty.
We're a long way from where we were last night at 10:30. Let's see. What was I doing?
Possibly I could tell you.
You've been reading the stars again, eh? All right, go on, tell me.
I was watching you with one of my men from the rear car as you killed Operative 77 on Tower Road. It was deftly done.
Well, I'll be a wart on a monkey's uncle. Don't tell me I'm here with the chief.
Chief of what?
But this is the guy I had Joe steal the papers for. Is this rich? Wish I could laugh without getting a pain in the face.
What's this all about, Ace?
Why, this guy is some big muckety-muck in some back alley country in Europe.
And thank you to respect my country as I do yours.
No offense, Matt, pal.
So you're both spies. Murdering, double-crossing spies.
Our activities were similar, only our motives were different.
Hey, what the devil is your real name, anyway?
Baron Rudolf Maximilian Taggart.
Quite a title. I think you got something there, Baron. Oh, we're proud to have you with us. Hey, look, why don't we all get together? Tell one another why we're here. We might whip this into a nice little drowning party. Come on, let's all gather around the stove and unburden ourselves. Fleming, you're first. You've been a flat tire ever since we started.
I'm afraid I have nothing to contribute.
Oh, being sermonized.
No, you got me all wrong, Ace.
Well, then, why has your chin been at half-mast all the way?
Don't mind my worthy colleague, Mr. Fleming. He hasn't learned to recognize tragedy on a man's face. Am I correct in thinking you'll welcome this too?
Don't be a sap, Baron. Any man that would welcome this ought to have his head examined, even after he's dead.
As a matter of fact, Ace, I do.
Now, don't you start telling us that your name isn't Fleming, and that you're running away because they found counterfeit money on you.
No, not running away. Pursuing.
Pursuing? Who?
My wife.
I don't get you.
She left yesterday for Europe to get a divorce. When I found it out, I could think of only one thing to do. To get to her and reason with her. Therefore, my sudden decision to leave last night.
Hard luck. I'm sorry, boss.
Oh, that's all right, Ace. It took a crack up to make me realize that no matter what I do, she's out of my life for good. So, you see, strangely enough, I do welcome this.
Well, I guess that accounts for everybody. The Baron's a red-hot patriot. Fleming's a subject for the Winchell column, and the kid... kid's a man without a country. Me.
How would you like your gravestone inscribed?
Here lies Ace Martin, born bad and grew up worse. Lived for the fun of it and died laughing.
I'd consider my career complete if I could have a drink. Oh, I forgot. Well, how about a smoke then?
There's four left. One for each of us.
Thanks, boy.
Look! I think I see a light.
I've been seeing a million.
There it is!
Are you guys kidding me?
No, it's a steamer! A steamer!
What's the matter, Baron? You taking an interest in life again?
Well, how about one of you guys shooting off the flare gun?
Get the flare gun, Joe.
Captain!
Flare off the port side, sir.
Stand by to lower a boat.
Man a boat. Full speed ahead.
This crate will never stay up until that ship gets here.
We'll break out the life belts then.
Go ahead, Joe. This one's no good.
Neither is this one. There's only one.
Well, ain't that ducky. Well, women and children first.
I regret, gentlemen, that the duty to my country forces me to take this step. Kindly hand over that belt.
Better give it to him, Joe.
What's this all about?
In fairness to you, Mr. Martin, I must warn you that I'm armed.
Yeah? With that toy pistol, eh?
It's a real one this time. Let me have those plans, please.
Don't do it, Ace!
What's the odds, kid? One peep out of you, Baron Rudolf Maximilian Taggart, and you'll be face to face with your illustrious ancestors.
Better company, any...
Kid, come here quick.
Take these plans and put them in your pocket. Hurry up. Now get into that lifeboat. Hurry up.
Go ahead, kid. It's okay.
Nice flying, boss.
You all set?
Yeah.
Now beat it.
Thanks, Ace.
Skip it. Give my regards to Ruth.
Goodbye.
Goodbye, Mr. Fleming.
Goodbye.
Good luck, kid.
Be gone?
Yes, he's on his way.
Baron. Did I finish you off?
Not quite up to your usual standard, Mr. Martin.
I'm sorry, Baron, but it had to be done.
Oh, indeed. You are a strange fellow, Martin. In spite of everything, I confess a strong liking for you. Under other circumstances, we might have been good friends.
Thanks, Baron. Well, now that we've regenerated or rejuvenated or what have you, how about a smoke? Superstitious, Baron?
Yes. Only about men who are born bad and grow up worse.